Good evening, and thank you all for coming. Before I begin, I would like to express my heartfelt thank you to Kempo Kalsung, Chodron Kunga, and all the Sangha of Tsechen Kunchab Ling here in Walden, New York, for inviting me to give this short presentation. And a special thank you to Ani Jampa for technical assistance in bringing it to you. I have also been asked to show you a picture of me, as it sometimes helps to associate a face with the voice that you will be hearing. My name is Randy Kuehnel, and I grew up in New York, studied geophysics up the road in Binghamton many years ago, but I am presently living in the suburbs of Washington, D.C. Tonight, I will be talking about the powerful earthquake which struck Nepal on April 25th of this year, 2015. By now, most of you have seen countless images and have heard or read of the devastation that resulted, both in terms of the suffering and loss of life, as well as the destruction of buildings, roads, infrastructure, and the community as a whole. My focus tonight, rather, will be on the study of this earthquake from the viewpoint of a seismologist, or the title given to those who study earthquakes. We cannot prevent most earthquakes from occurring, but by better understanding the process of how earthquakes happen, we hope to be able to diminish the suffering they cause. So tonight I will be giving you a very basic crash course in seismology, or the name given to the study of earthquakes. In particular, what is an earthquake and what causes them? How do we measure them and determine their magnitude? What are the types of earthquake waves? How do we locate them, and where are they likely to occur? What we know about this particular earthquake in Nepal, and can we predict where the next one will occur? While I will be talking about seismology in general terms, whenever possible I will refer specifically to this particular event in Nepal, and perhaps even to some features of our Earth closer to home. And this is just the starting point. In this age of information, one can easily expand and clarify what you've heard tonight by visiting other educational websites, such as the U.S. Geological Survey at usgs.gov, or the Incorporated Research Institutions for Seismology at iris.edu, and many, many others. So let's start at the beginning. What is an earthquake? An earthquake is the shaking of the ground which results from the sudden movement of two blocks of earth past each other. The area where the two blocks slip past each other is called a fault or a fault plain, which essentially is a cracked region of rock which is weaker than the blocks surrounding it. The location below the surface where the earthquake starts is called the hypocenter, or the focus, and the place on earth directly above that is called the epicenter. There are three basic types of faults, as shown in the following diagram. Strike-slip fault, normal fault, and a thrust fault. In the strike-slip fault, shown in the top figure, the two blocks are actually sliding horizontally past one another. The right block moving into the page, and the left block moving out of the page. This is the type of faulting that is occurring at the famous San Andreas Fault in California. As you can see from the middle and bottom figures, the orientation of faults themselves are exactly the same. What is different are the forces or the stresses that are pushing on each of the blocks, as indicated by the arrows. In normal faulting, shown in the middle figure, the forces on the blocks are pulling them apart, and in the bottom figure, the forces are squeezing them together. Normal faulting is occurring in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, where the seafloor is actually spreading apart, and North and South America are growing farther and farther away from Europe and Asia. The type of fault which ruptured in Nepal is a thrust fault, where the rocks on the Earth's surface are getting squeezed together. The important point is that if the blocks were free to slide along the fault all the time while under these forces or stresses, then there would be no sudden movement, and hence no earthquake would be felt. They would just slide gently along each other. While this is indeed the case at some faults, Most faults are actually stuck together for long periods of time, so the stress continues to build up over time until it suddenly gives way, and all of that stress is released as energy. This sudden release of energy is the earthquake that we feel. An analogy sometimes used is that of snapping one's fingers. The thumb and middle finger are squeezed together and slide against each other. The fault line is where they would be touching, until they finally quickly break from each other, resulting in the middle finger slapping against the palm. That snapping creates an energy wave which travels from our hand and out into the air as a sound wave, which then travels to our ear. Okay, now detecting that someone has snapped a finger is accomplished by our ear and all of its magical moving parts. But how can we measure the motion of the ground caused by an earthquake? For this we use a seismograph. The basic idea is very simple and is based upon the principle of inertia. That is, an object at rest tends to stay at rest. Take a look at this figure. The seismograph has a base that sits firmly on the ground here, and a heavy weight that hangs free here. When an earthquake causes the ground to shake, the base of the seismograph shakes along with the rotating drum, but the hanging weight does not. Instead, the spring, or the wire, or whatever is holding that up, absorbs all of the movement. The difference in position between the shaking part of the seismograph and the motionless weight is what is drawn on the paper below. This paper actually rotates around a drum so that it will draw a line which is kind of wiggly and traces out what the motion of the earth was. Okay, now on this picture we have 4 days of what we would call a drum recording for this earthquake. This is day 1 here, day 2, day 3, and day 4. So notice on day 424 there's very little happening. It's just drum recording, it's just drawing straight lines across, nothing's going on. The earth is staying pretty still. But then on the 25th of April, as we all know, there was a huge earthquake in Nepal. And that actually is this black one here that is the largest recording on the whole drum. In fact, it was so large that it actually went off of the drum, or what we would call clipped. So it was obviously a very large earthquake. And then it was followed by many aftershocks, what we call aftershocks. Those are smaller earthquakes, generally smaller, that are continue to shake for days and days after the main shock. So you can see on day 425, April 25th, there's lots and lots of aftershocks here. Each one of these little blips is an earthquake. So this little black one here is an earthquake. This red one is another one that's much bigger. You can see it's shaking much larger. And then on the 26th, you still have more aftershock activity. And then a pretty large one. This one I believe was above magnitude 6. Pretty good size aftershock. Many buildings that were still standing after the main shock fell down after this one. It was devastating. And then there are other smaller ones here. And they continue, and then on the next day, the following day, there are fewer earthquakes and generally smaller in size. And this pattern will continue for days and days and weeks, eventually will quiet down to what you have here, the activity in that area that was before the earthquake. As of this date, there have been something like 350 aftershocks of magnitude 4 or greater. And that's according to the Nepalese National Seismological Center. Now, as can be seen from this, these drum recordings can be a little complicated to read because there's so many earthquakes and they're writing all over each other. So nowadays, the recordings are rarely drawn on paper, except for display purposes or in a museum. But they're really nice for instructions like this to give you a nice snapshot of what's going on. So they're measured, they measure them electronically and save them onto a computer, but the basic principles are the same. Also, I want to mention there's many different kinds of seismometers, depending on what type of ground motion that the scientists want to measure. There's some called strain meters, which measure very slow movements in the Earth, or accelerometers, which can measure very powerful movements. In fact, in most of your smartphones today, I'm going to pause for a second here. In your smartphone, you actually have a seismometer. You know that thing that magically knows which way you're orienting your phone? That is actually an accelerometer that's inside your smartphone that detects the movement. As you move it down, there are little plates that are shaking back and forth, and they measure the distance between these plates, and that's a seismometer, and that's what's doing it. So you are actually carrying a seismometer. Those of you that have smartphones, I don't. I'm living in the Stone Ages myself, but that's kind of neat, I think, anyway. It's all the same principle, the exact principle of inertia. All right, so now that seismologists had a way of recording the ground motion accompanying an earthquake using seismometers, they soon discovered that earthquakes looked very different depending on where they were recorded and where the earthquake actually came from. For example, here are recordings of the same Nepal earthquake at several stations around the world, which are different distances from the epicenter. The closer stations are at the top of the figure. And while these may all just look like a big mess of wiggly lines, it is from these differences that scientists learn the most. The first seismologists noticed that there were specific types of waves created when a fault plane ruptured. The details of all these differences could probably take up to a year of lectures, but the basics are as follows. There are two general types of waves, body waves and surface waves. A body wave can travel through the Earth, whereas surface waves only travel along the surface of the Earth, and hence the name surface waves. So on this left figure here, you have the earthquake down here, and the body waves are traveling through the Earth, either along that way or along that way or anywhere in there, and they're reaching the surface. The surface waves are only up here, and they're traveling right along the surface here. And this is kind of a nice figure for several reasons. I like the way the waves are going up like this, because there are certain surface waves that really behave very much like ocean waves. They're called Rayleigh waves. And then the other thing that's kind of neat about this is this building that's doing the hula dance here. It's actually not as funny as you'd think, because buildings actually do that, especially larger ones, from these surface waves. And what they've learned is that it's really important. I mean, I'm not an earthquake structural engineer or anything, but one thing that they did learn was that, you know, making a stiff building is not really the way to prevent it from being destroyed during an earthquake. You actually have to have a building that flexes and bends. Another thing is the way the foundation is, sometimes if it's connected to the ground, it will fare better. and sometimes they have ones that, you know, if it's not connected to the ground, it just kind of slides and tips over. But I think I've even heard of some buildings where they actually the foundation actually will slide a little bit to absorb some of that energy. As I said, this is not really my field at all, but it's fascinating and really is at the crux of why we study earthquakes. Because, you know, as they say, earthquakes don't kill people. It's actually the buildings that do. Anyway, the other thing about this that I think is really cool is the soil layer here. Sometimes with the surface waves, the energy gets trapped in this layer when you have a soft soil layer. And this is, I'm going to talk about this a little bit later. This is really some of the problems that happened in Kathmandu, why the earthquake was so devastating there. Now on the right figure here, I just want to quickly show that the body waves And the surface waves can be further divided based on the direction that the Earth shakes back and forth with respect to the direction the wave is traveling through the Earth. Now that sounds a little bit, might be a little confusing, but let me kind of demonstrate that if I can. Up here. All right, so new slide, same figures. On the right here, I started talking about the body waves. So the direction of propagation of the energy is up here, shown by these arrows. So these are up here on the top, shows a P wave. A P wave, they're sort of showing here a hammer that's hitting this block of whatever. And you hit it there, and then the energy travels up there. And it goes sort of, it's traveling in that direction, but the motion is actually up and down as the energy travels. And so they just show the energy, the wave propagation up that way. The S wave, they're showing hitting the from the side here. And so what it's doing, it's making this brick or whatever sort of swing side to side, and the energy travels up like that. Those are called S waves or shear waves. And but the energy still travels in that direction, but the Earth shakes sort of perpendicular to that, kind of like as a snake sort of thing. And then the surface waves, they're sort of combinations of these two. Surface waves essentially are body waves that are trapped, kind of what I was talking about here, where they get trapped in this soil layer. They're basically trapped near the Earth's surface, and they just will propagate along. And this just shows the way the ground shakes. This here are the Rayleigh waves, where I talk were like the ocean. And these are sort of analogous to throwing a pebble into a still lake and seeing how the waves travel out in a large ring from where the pebble hit the lake. That's something like Rayleigh waves. P waves here are just like sound waves. They travel exactly the same as sound waves, much faster because they're traveling through rock, but the idea is the same. They travel through solids, liquids, everything. S waves, the important thing about them is they travel through solids, but they cannot travel through liquids. And that's really important from a seismological view. I don't know whether I'm going to get into that too much, but maybe a little later I'll touch on that one. Okay, on this picture I just want to show some more seismograms from the Nepal earthquake. These were recorded in Alaska, about a quarter of the way around the Earth. I've labeled the P wave, the S wave, and the surface waves here. Let me see if I can do this. I'm having trouble with this laser pointer. There we go. P wave, S wave, and the surface waves. So the P waves are this one here. The S waves are there, but they're stronger on the north, south, and east-west component because that's the way that the Earth actually shakes in that direction. If you didn't get that, it's okay. And then the surface waves, they're the largest, and these actually cause most of the damage from earthquakes, the surface waves. But when an earthquake is large and close, the P waves and the S waves are going to do some damage too. The P waves a little less so, but S waves can truly do a lot of damage for close-in earthquakes. P waves, this is kind of interesting. Sometimes animals can detect them. We may not be able to. So sometimes you may hear, and there were reports from this earthquake where the dogs and started barking and, goats bleeding and things like that just prior to people actually feeling the shaking. And that's generally the P wave is animals seem to be more sensitive. But people can feel it for sure, especially on an earthquake of this size. And I should say, an earthquake of this size, but also an earthquake that is recorded very close, or if you're very close to an earthquake, you'll be able to feel the body waves, the P wave and the S wave. The other thing I want to say is the P wave actually was named because it's the fastest traveling wave. It always arrives first on a seismogram, or a seismogram is another word for the recording of the earthquake. The P wave from this one took about 12 minutes to arrive at this station. P wave, they said, initially stood for primary. The S wave, or the secondary wave, travels slower than a P wave, so always will arrive later than the P waves. And this is actually, I'm mentioning this fact because it's really important, and it can be used to determine where the earthquake occurred. Okay. Okay. To understand how this works, how we can use the P wave and the S wave to locate an earthquake, an analogy that's often used is comparing P and S waves to lightning and thunder. Light travels faster than sound, so during a thunderstorm, you'll first see the lightning and then you'll hear the thunder. We all know this. We've been doing it since we're kids, right? You count how many seconds after the thunder from when you saw the lightning, and then you know how far away the lightning bolt was. So if you're closer to the lightning, the thunder will boom right after the lightning. But if you're farther away from the lightning, you can count several seconds before you hear the thunder. So the further you are from the storm, the longer it will take between the lightning and the thunder. And P waves are like the lightning, and S waves are like the thunder. The P waves travel faster and shake the ground where you are first. Then the S waves follow and shake the ground also. If you're close to the earthquake, the P and S waves will come right after one another. But if you're farther away, there will be more time between the two. So here we have three different earthquakes here. Three recordings of the same exact earthquake. On the top one here, we have the P wave here and the S wave here, and they're pretty close. They're 1.5 minutes separated from each other. At a different station, the P wave and the S wave are separated by 3 minutes. And at another station, even further away, they're separated by 5 minutes. And so seismologists have figured out, you know, how this time difference can actually be converted into a distance from the epicenter. And basically, it's really straightforward, and I'm probably not explaining this very clearly, but if you have the station here, and you just draw a circle that's 18, for example, this middle one is 1,800 kilometers away. You draw a circle that's 1,800 kilometer radius around that one, and then you draw another circle for the other two stations. So this is station one, the closest station here in blue. So that one was 900 kilometers. And then the one that was furthest away, the green one, up here in Pennsylvania, not too far from where we are, that one is going to have a very big circle of 3,300 kilometers away. And where these three circles intersect, that's the location of the earthquake. It's easy as that. If you didn't get it, don't worry about it. But it's explained really nicely at IRIS or iris.edu. They do a nice job of explaining this if anyone's interested in that. But it's basically thunder and lightning. That's it. And that's how we locate earthquakes, or one of the ways. There's several ways, but that's really the meat of the issue there. All right, so now that we know how to locate an earthquake, let's see what happens when we start placing all of the locations of the earthquakes on a map of the Earth. This map here shows all the earthquakes greater than magnitude 4.5 for the year 2013. Each of the yellow dots shows the location of a single earthquake. And notice that they're kind of focused on lines here, which actually break up the Earth into little pieces. This would be an example of one of them. Here would be another one, something like this down here. There's some little ones here, little ones there. Anyway, these are all what they call tectonic plates. And scientists have determined that these plates aren't just sitting around here. They're actually moving around. And as these plates are rubbing against each other, that's what's causing earthquakes. That's it. That is the force that's causing these plates to grind. You know, earlier I had pictures of faults, and there were arrows there, and there were this, you know, who's pushing these things? Well, it's these plates that are grinding against each other. Okay, so once again, it's really important to note that these plates are not just drifting randomly were sitting there doing nothing, but they're actually being driven in specific directions for very long periods of time. This global map that I've just put up here shows the plates labeled in with yellow boxes. They've given the names, like this is the African plate, for example. And the red arrows show the directions that they're moving. So you can see here the Mid-Atlantic Ridge I talked about. These are what they call normal faults. The plate, this plate here, the North American plate, is going in that direction, and the African plate is going in that direction. And so you get normal faulting right along here in the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. Here in the San Andreas, you have this plate here, which is kind of cut off the edge of the thing, but that's moving in that direction, and that would be what they'd call a transverse fault or a strike-slip fault, and all the earthquakes along the San Andreas here are slight strike-slip faults. And then the last one is this one here. This is the compressive faults or the thrust faulting. This is India over here. And that's being pressed against the Eurasian plate in that way. And this collision here between this continent of India and the continent of Eurasia is what's causing the Himalayas. And that's it. That pretty much explains the idea of why mountains are being formed. And they're so huge there because this plate can't, they both want to float. This guy wants to stay on the surface, and this guy wants to stay on the surface, and they're just going to mash into each other. And that's why you have huge mountain range in the Himalayas. All right, on this slide, I just want to show a little more, sort of a cartoon figure of what's happening with the plates. Wherever there's plates being collided with each other, the collision, creation, and destruction of all these plates not only will cause the earthquakes, but also creates the volcanoes and all the mountains that we see. I just talked about that a little bit with the Himalayas. But this whole process of creation of plates here at the spreading ridge, like in the Mid-Atlantic, and where plates are diving underneath each other and crashing into each other, forming volcanoes and large mountain ranges. This is what they call plate tectonics. And I'm sure many of you have heard of that term, but that's really the driving force for what we see on the Earth today. All right, so what is causing these plates to move? They're not just blowing in the wind or anything. There's got to be something that's pushing them around. And we said that they're not just drifting aimlessly. They actually will move in specific directions for many, many, many years, millions of years at a time. So what is causing them? Basically, what scientists have discovered is that the inside of the Earth is hot. And as the Earth is cooling, the material inside the Earth is actually forming what they call convection currents. So it's very hot here down in the center of the Earth, and that heat rises, and when it reaches the surface, it may cause what we would call the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, and that's one of the forces that are causing the plates to separate from each other. So these convection currents are actually dragging the plates along as they kind of spin around. So the reason why they're spinning around is it comes up hot and then it stays here near the cooler surface, and then it gets cooler and that causes it to drop down. So as you know, hot things rise like a hot air balloon, and when they cool down the balloon or whatever they do with the fire there, the air inside the balloon will get cooler and that will bring it down. It's the same principle inside the Earth. Hot things rise, cool things sink, and that's the same principle you see when you're cooking food. When things are bubbling up in your pot of soup or whatever, those are basically convection currents carrying the heat from the bottom of the flame up towards the surface. So next time you're cooking food, you can say that you're witnessing plate tectonics in action. All right, the question is, how do we even know that the interior of the Earth is behaving like this? It's too deep, you can't drill down into there. So how do we know? First of all, we know that qualitatively, just in first principles, that the interior of the Earth is hot, because we see volcanoes erupting, melted rock. And that hot rock obviously must come from inside the Earth. So we know the interior of the Earth is hot. But more quantitatively, in other words, using numbers and something that you can put your finger on, geophysicists actually use the energy waves or the seismic waves created by earthquakes to study the deep interior of the Earth in very much the same way that we use X-rays to see the inside of our bodies. So this diagram here shows a cutout of the globe with an earthquake that's occurring at the very top here. All right, up there is an earthquake. So the waves are traveling outward along all different paths. Each one of these is an earthquake wave. All these little things here imagine them to be earthquake stations. So you have the earthquake here, and along one of these lines here, you have earthquake waves traveling, and they're recorded at that station. And then over here, these are actually the seismograms from that particular station. So they're just wiggling. It's not very clear because there's so much information squeezed into this little slide. But the basic idea is that when you have an earthquake, you're putting energy inside the Earth. And all these different pathways are really almost exactly analogous to how an X-ray works. In fact, a CAT scan, because it's three-dimensional. So they're traveling in all different directions at different things. And you can see, based on these little wiggles over here, what happened to the Earth, to the energy as it passed through the Earth. And this is what seismologists do, and this is what I spent a lot of my life doing, looking at these little wiggly lines here and learning about the inside of the Earth. Totally fascinating to me. One of the really neat things I just want to mention, they learned from seismic waves that this part here is what they call the outer core of the Earth. It behaves actually like a liquid. I don't know if you remember, I mentioned that S waves cannot travel through liquids. So when you have an earthquake energy coming here and it hits you don't see S waves on this side of the Earth, because the energies here can travel as an S wave and reach a station there. But if the energy is traveling down here and it hits here, all the S waves die because they're just absorbed. They can't propagate through a liquid. And so there's no S waves from here all the way around to the same distance there. And that's how they know. That's how they know the outer core of the Earth is liquid, from using seismic waves. And that, I think, is really cool. Because you see that the seismic energy that has such potential to cause so much damage also has the potential to reveal information we could not otherwise have access to. And that's really the power of seismology. All right, so in short, the plates are moving about because the Earth is trying to cool itself off. And that's what it has been trying to do since it was created. So the idea of plate tectonics actually now had an explanation. Using other techniques, scientists were able to determine actually how fast the plates are moving today relative to each other. On average, about as fast as your fingernail grows. Not only which way they're moving now, but to show where they have been in the past. Just kind of rewind the clock a little bit. And it turns out, actually, all the continents that we see today were joined together into one supercontinent that scientists have called Pangaea. So on the top here, I've kind of, they have a picture of, this is, each one of these pictures are advancing time. So 225 million years ago, all the continents were joined together into Pangaea. And I just want to show you where India was in that whole mess. I've highlighted that and drawn a little arrow there, just to show you. So as time goes by, these things will separate from each other, and you'll see India is going to start sliding up here. It used to be attached to Antarctica, and this is Australia flying off in that direction. This is Africa, South America, and North America, and Asia. So here we have India flying up here, heading where we know it's headed, and that is Eurasia. So eventually, India reached there and crashed into Asia, and that's what why the Himalayas are there. I've talked about this already, but all the whole configuration of these plates actually, you know, they fit together like a puzzle, and it's not really it's not an exact science. Most of it fits perfectly. I mean, they're little fragments that are pretty difficult to explain, but scientists have been amazing in how they've been able to connect these things using fossils in different ways. They figured out where they've been. So the point of this is that India has traveled up and crashed into Asia. And on the bottom figure here, I have sort of a side view. So this is India now seen from the side, and this is the Eurasian plate over here. So India is crashing into there, and the plate is actually diving underneath the Eurasian plate. And so you have the high Himalayas as this plate goes under, and the Eurasia plate wants to stay where it is, and that's just kind of bumping up the whole works. So you have these gigantic mountains here as India is traveling underneath, and the Tibetan plateau is behind it. Actually, that's a little lower. That's a little more complicated to explain, but the important thing is this is thrust faulting. This is a gigantic thrust fault here where these two plates are meeting each other. And there's not just one thrust fault, but many that have causing this. It's not really so neat and schematic as this picture shows, but that's the general idea. Thrust faulting, that's the birth of the Himalayas. And it is along one of these thrust faults which broke during the earthquake in Nepal that happened on April 25th of this year. So it all fits into place. Now, on this one, I just want to show a little aside here, which is kind of brings it a little closer to home. This is the Pangaea. When Pangaea actually was formed by a bunch of continents that used to be separated, sort of in the, you know, roughly kind of how the Earth is now, all the continents separated, and they actually came together to form Pangaea. The formation of Pangaea actually created the Appalachian Mountains. Here is kind of North America here. Sorry, I don't have my highlighter. I forgot to turn my highlighter on. Here we go. Here, North America. And here, this actually is Africa. So prior to the formation of the supercontinent Pangaea, this continent came up and crashed into this continent. And that created this large mountain range that we call the Appalachians. And this kind of continent collision is the same process that's forming the Himalayas today. It's really quite an analogy that really works. The details are more complicated than what I'm saying here, but basically it's a continent collision, just like what's happening in the Himalayas, formed the Appalachians that you see all around you today. And I think that's really fascinating. And the reason why the Appalachians aren't as high as the Himalayas is because it happened so long ago that they've been eroded down. Some estimates put them as high as the Himalayas when they were in their prime, so to speak. Okay, so once again, I just want to show this this diagram here. The earthquakes that we would expect in the Himalayas are not actually going to occur on one specific fault, like I was along here. Just several faults here. Some of them are labeled in this bottom one, but one of these faults actually was the one that broke during that earthquake on the 25th of April. Because as these plates are pushing against each other, they're not sliding continuously. Some people believe that actually the lower layers are sliding continuously, but the upper layers, which are cooler, actually stick together and then break during large earthquakes. So let's take a quick look at in more detail about what actually happened on the 25th of April. So at 11:56:26 Nepal Standard Time, a magnitude 7.8 earthquake with an epicenter approximately 80 kilometers or 50 miles northwest of Kathmandu. So here we have Kathmandu and the epicenter up here. So the depth of the epicenter, or the depth of the earthquake, was about 15 kilometers, about 9 miles below the surface. Once again, that would be called the hypocenter. But I want to talk about the magnitude. What is the magnitude? The magnitude of the earthquake, they said, was 7.8. Some are now saying 7.9. Magnitude is, in the simplest terms, is determined by how much the earthquake shook the seismometer. So I'm going to go back briefly to the picture of the drum recording and show how we can measure the magnitude of an earthquake. All right, so here again we have the drum recording. And as I mentioned earlier, a lot of these aftershocks, the main shock was this large black one, and there were many, many aftershocks in here. And so I'm just going to pick two of the aftershocks. This one here, this green one here, it's very hard, even hard for me to see. Maybe you can see it, but it kind of goes about as high as there. I've measured the top as high as it goes up here, and then as low as it goes down here. And I've done the same with another little teeny aftershock here in blue, and I've measured how low it goes there and how high it goes here. And I'm just going to call that A with a blue A, and then the distance between these as a green B. This distance here is called the amplitude. That's the largest excursion, you could say, that it does on the seismogram. Now, for the sake of argument, we're just going to assume that this earthquake A and earthquake B were the same distance away, because we know that the closer an earthquake is to the recording station, the larger it's going to be. So let's assume that they were the same distance away. I really don't know any details about these earthquakes, these particular ones, but for the sake of argument, I could say they're pretty close in distance, but that's very qualitative. Statement there. But assuming that they're the same distance away, obviously earthquake B must be much larger than earthquake A. And it traveled the same distance, but it shook the seismometer more. It must be a bigger earthquake. And that's essentially what magnitude is. If you measured the distance here, the amplitude of this small blue one, it's about 10 times less than that one. I kind of picked this on purpose. So the magnitude of if this earthquake A is 10 times less, or the amplitude is 10 times less than this, then they're separated by a magnitude difference of 1. In other words, let's assume this blue one has a magnitude of 3. This B earthquake would have a magnitude of 4. So if the amplitude is 10 times larger, then the magnitude goes up by 1. And that's basically what magnitude is. This scale was developed by Richter, and they call that the Richter scale, which is very common. Pretty much everyone knows or has heard of that thing as a measurement of earthquakes. But nowadays, the Richter scale had some problems for early seismologists. It didn't do a very good job talking about describing large earthquakes. So they developed something else in the late 70s called the moment magnitude scale, and that's denoted as an MW. And sometimes you'll see this on some of my pictures that I have here. It'll say an M with a small W next to it. So briefly, the details are a little beyond what I have time, and I think I've already gone way over my limit here. But the main point is that the moment magnitude actually can tell you about physical properties of the earthquake, such as how large the fault surface was which ruptured, and how far the two sides of the fault slid past each other. And in fact, one of the more interesting things is actually how much energy was released. In fact, that little W in MW stands for the amount of work which was accomplished by that earthquake. So, but the idea is the same. For every increase, the moment magnitude scale basically behaves like the Richter magnitude scale, except for large earthquakes, where the Richter magnitude kind of falls apart. But the important thing at the moment magnitude scale, if you go up from one, if you go from like a magnitude moment magnitude of 4 to a moment magnitude of 5, it releases 32 times the energy. So there's a really excellent explanation of this at iris.edu, and actually uses the analogy of breaking uncooked spaghetti to explain this. It's kind of neat. I'm going to try to summarize the old spaghetti quake explanation that I just talked about. Briefly, imagine the amount of energy it would take to bend a piece of spaghetti until it broke. You know, the fault surface area would then be that little round surface which used to connect the two broken pieces of spaghetti. So if we called this a magnitude 5 spaghetti quake, you know, the energy required to break one piece of spaghetti, then to create a magnitude 6 spaghetti quake, we'd need to hold 32 pieces of spaghetti together and then break them simultaneously. And that one I've kind of shown here with the blue square. The magnitude 5 is this red dot, one piece of spaghetti. This is kind of a side view of the spaghetti. So magnitude 6 would be 32 pieces of spaghetti, shown by this kind of square here. And then a magnitude 7 is 1,000 pieces of spaghetti. And that would be all of these in this large thing. So that gives you an idea of how the magnitudes change. So magnitude five spaghetti quake or earthquake is 1,000 times less or weaker than a magnitude 7 earthquake. And that's just to give you an idea of how those energies, how a magnitude can be converted into something like energy. Yeah, that's about it on that one. On this picture, I just want to show some of the relationships between some of the famous earthquakes and what their energy equivalents were. here on the left, we have the magnitude scale. And our earthquake was a 7.9, the Nepal earthquake, so I'm going to call it like an 8. That's about the same as the San Francisco earthquake, and also is about roughly the same energy released as the Mount St. Helens eruption in 1980. And this they have in terms of kilotons of TNT. Is that 15 billion? Am I counting? Yeah, 15 billion kilotons of TNT is the energy released by a magnitude 8 earthquake. And so it just puts it into perspective. Another thing to note about this thing is that there are about a dozen magnitude 8 earthquakes a year. Roughly. I mean, they have one here, but it's really between let me put it this way. There's about a dozen earthquakes between magnitude 7 and magnitude 7.9 per year. So they're happening all the time. I mean, there's magnitude 3, magnitude 2 down here are earthquakes. There's, you know, a million of them every year. And so earthquakes are happening all the time. There's some of the great earthquakes, like the Chile earthquake of 1960, the largest one, magnitude 9.5. Those are very rare. But we've had a few. We've had the large earthquake that caused the tsunami in Indonesia, and the one in Japan in 2011. Those are great earthquakes, nearly magnitude 9s. Okay, on this picture, I'm just showing before and after picture. You see a lot of these on the internet, before and after pictures of things. This was the, once again, we said the Mount St. Helens eruption was about the same energy as the Nepal earthquake, or released about the same. So here's a picture of Mount St. Helens before and after, where it's blown to bits. And then the Nepal earthquake, here's a beautiful old building that was reduced to rubble. So these kind of before and after pictures, they're all over the internet, and they're really tell you how devastating this earthquake was. You know, once again, our mantra here, buildings, earthquakes don't kill people. It's actually buildings that do. So that's, there's, yeah. All right, so let's talk about the location of this earthquake again. What you often see is a point on a map, such as above, or such as in this slide, which shows the epicenter here, about 80 kilometers or so northwest of Kathmandu. This is all technically true, because the epicenter actually shows where the earthquake started. But the finer details of this are a little more interesting and go a long way in explaining why there was so much damage in the capital of Kathmandu. The first point to remember is that an earthquake is caused by motion not actually at a point, but describes movement on a whole fault plane, especially a large earthquake, you know, of this magnitude. But how do we even know where the fault was which ruptured? This earthquake actually didn't break the surface anywhere. You might see pictures showing cracks in the road, but that's not from the fault. That's actually settling of the earth. This case, I don't believe to this date they've actually found surface rupture from this earthquake. So how do they know which fault ruptured? And the easiest way actually is by looking at the aftershocks. And the aftershocks, again, are smaller earthquakes which generally occur on the same fault plane which ruptured during the larger main shock. So we spent a lot of time talking about how to locate earthquakes, and here's where that knowledge is really going to become helpful. All right, so this figure actually shows the location of a bunch of aftershocks, each as a dot. Once again, Kathmandu is down here in this area, and then each of these dots are an aftershock, This thing, you can see the aftershocks are kind of spread over an area, something like this. They're color-coded basically in time. So the main shock was over here, as we said, northwest of Kathmandu. And so all the red dots here occurred, these are all aftershocks that occurred within the first 24 hours. And then the yellow ones, the yellow dots are earthquakes which occurred in the, you know, the first week after the main shock, and then the light blue ones are ones that occurred in 16 days, and then the red ones are 17 days after the main shock. And there was a large earthquake on the 12th of May, which you may recall. It was a pretty big aftershock, 7.3, that occurred here. And so there's a fair amount of little aftershocks around there, but actually this is considered an aftershock of the main earthquake, even though it's a big earthquake in its own right. So the point here is that all of these aftershocks actually are defining the fault plane which ruptured. And wouldn't you know, Kathmandu's right in the, almost in the middle of this large area. So the fault which ruptured, it wasn't in an area, you know, far away from Kathmandu. It was right underneath it. And that's why there was so much destruction there. So sometimes you see these maps that have just a point somewhere, but really, an earthquake is a fault, and large earthquakes break large faults. And Kathmandu, unfortunately, was right on top of this one. So when seismologists study in detail the data from many different stations which measured the earthquake, they're able to look at even finer details. This image here is actually a pretty advanced image. It has a lot of information, but one thing it shows that's kind of interesting, and I want to just point out a couple of things here. The earthquake, here's Kathmandu down here, and here's the epicenter where it started. It shows that the earthquake actually came in distinct phases. It started rupturing that way, and then it kind of came over here and ruptured down there, and then it ruptured. So it wasn't just a big plane here sliding at the same time. It actually started one place and wiggled around and shook and bounced all over the place, you know, for 55 seconds, they say here. Some other estimates are, you know, up to 80 seconds or more. So that's how long it took for this whole fault area to break. The other thing is when you add up all these pieces, these little pieces of energy, and you collapse all that energy back into a point again, the main energy can actually ends up being right underneath Kathmandu again. So not only the fault plane was around Kathmandu, but the energy that was released around that whole fault actually is focused right underneath there if you collapsed it all in. So really, Kathmandu got hammered, and you don't need pictures. You don't need me to tell you that. There's plenty of pictures that are saying the same thing. And so it's all the science and the photos are given the same answer, unfortunately. Or I should say fortunately. I mean, at least the science is confirming what we saw happen. But unfortunate for the people and of there. The maximum that the fault slipped was somewhere between 3 and 4 meters. That's just so that's whatever, good 10 or so feet that the earthquake actually slipped. So the Indian plate slid underneath the Eurasian plate by about 10 feet or so during this one earthquake. So we said the earthquake moved about 10 feet or so, or the fault slipped about 10 feet, but how does this motion along the fault translate into how much the Earth shifted at the Earth's surface? Scientists can also determine this using satellites, such as the GPS, which you may recognize, and you know that's another thing that's in your smartphone, by the way. So you have a lot of neat seismological tools that you're carrying around in your pocket, which you may not even have known about. Anyway, one can see from this picture here that the center of the displacement, this in red here, deep red, is showing up movement. Let me turn on my laser pointer again. This red movement is showing that the Earth actually went up, and the blue is showing that the Earth actually went down. So the Himalayas are over here. Here's Mount Everest, just as a reference. And this is kind of what the lesser Himalayas, I guess they call it, Kathmandu area. So the maximum amount of uplift here, which was about a meter or a meter and a half, was right around Kathmandu again. So everything agrees that Kathmandu really got hit hard. About a meter and a half here in Kathmandu, and actually the Himalayas went down by about a half a meter or so in this blue area. These black arrows here are showing how much the Earth shifted horizontally, and they are saying something as well, a couple of meters southwards around there. So even though the earthquake shifted a lot down deep, even at the surface, it's still several meters of motion there. So yeah, there's so many reasons why this earthquake was terrible. So on this picture, why did the Himalayas go down, and Kathmandu went up? The way we can understand this, to look what happens before and after an earthquake along a thrust fault. So here's kind of a cartoon of a thrust fault. The top picture shows the two plates pushing against each other. Here's the India plate here and the Eurasia plate that way. And so if the earthquake is locked here, what actually happens is the Earth is deformed. The Earth actually behaves like an elastic. It's not really stiff like what you think rock when you're pushing at it for years and years under huge stresses. It actually behaves like an elastic. So down here, this would be equivalent to where Kathmandu was. The Earth actually was going down, and up here in the Himalayas it was going up, and that's just because of these forces. And when the fault actually breaks, this deflection downward rebounds back up to where the baseline should be. So what was down here, this blue traced area, was the lower part. That actually bounced up after the earthquake. And that's why the land actually went up here in Kathmandu, and it went down in the Himalayas. So it all makes sense from a geophysical point of view, but it may not make intuitive sense when you just think about, you know, earthquakes sliding along. The Earth is not a solid; it's more like an elastic, at least at the surface. And as we know, the Earth is also a liquid when you go down deep inside. So there's a lot of weird things going on here, but it all makes sense in the end. So in this picture, I wanted to show, we know that the earthquake was essentially right below the capital city of Kathmandu, but now I'm going to show a close view of the topography of Kathmandu and the area around it. Once again, this red arrow here is showing up here in the left, is showing the the main shock here. We know that the earthquake actually occurred underneath here. But here's Kathmandu, and I've highlighted the outside of it, and you can see from the topography, Kathmandu is pretty flat. It's all the same shade, this gray area. So what that is that this is showing, and anyone who's been there, and I haven't, but people who have been there know that it's relatively flat compared to what's around there, and that actually is because this is an old ancient lake bed, which has since dried up. And all this is lake sediments that are here under Kathmandu. And I just want to point that out because, as I mentioned earlier, when we were talking about that the building doing the hula dance and the sediments there, here's Kathmandu, same scenario. So Kathmandu is not built on solid rock, but actually loose sediments. And by some estimates, they estimate them to be about 2,000 feet thick of sediments. And while, of course, it's easier to build a city where there's less topography, but the problem is, from an earthquake point of view, earthquake waves get amplified in soft sediments because there's hard rock below it, and that energy gets trapped in there. And we talked a little bit about that earlier, and that's just a disaster from an earthquake point of view. Okay, this is just another picture showing that Kathmandu is built on an old lake. These are the sediments down here. I don't know what the elephant's doing there, but that elephant is not giving any scale. This lake is much bigger than an elephant. So these are the sediments, and the earthquake energy gets trapped in here. And up here is a picture of Kathmandu, all flat, and the mountains in the background, and for so many reasons, the earthquake, the buildings that are on this sediments shake around. You know, you can have a perfectly well-designed building, but if the foundation's on loose rock, it's just going to tip right over. And there were many instances in photos that I looked at where you see these buildings that are sort of intact but just tilted over. So it's just there's a lot of issues with building there. I mean, it's a developing country, and it has financial issues, political issues, but this clearly was a disaster waiting to happen. All right. On this picture, this is just kind of summarizing the other picture. When you have rock here in the lower area going on soft sediment, the amplitude of the earthquake waves are going to be lower as they travel through the rock, and once they reach the soft sediment, the amplitudes get much larger, and that's essentially it's what they call site amplification, and that's really what happened under Kathmandu. So this large shaking we clearly saw in the photos, but you can also see this in what we call a shake map, or something, an intensity scale, which is one of the intensity scales is called the modified Mercalli intensity scale. And I just want to talk about this quickly here. Intensity scales are different from magnitude scales because the earthquake magnitude scale is a measure of the energy that the earthquake released. An intensity scale measures more of how the ground actually shook, which changes from place to place depending on the distance of the earthquake and the soil and rock conditions we've talked about and other factors. So in other words, these intensity scales attempt to describe what people felt and the destruction it caused to buildings and natural features. And these intensity scales go from 1 to 12, where 1 would be not felt at all and 12 is extreme destruction. So the next figure I'm going to show is going to show a shake map, which is basically an intensity map for this earthquake. And what you'll see is, I'll just show you the picture. So what we see here is, once again, the worst shaking is right around an area around Kathmandu. Kathmandu is this little spot here. There's our epicenter up here, and this box here is a model of just a rough estimate of the shape of the fault. So the darker areas are going to be higher intensity, or you know, more violent shaking. And in this case, some of the shaking actually went up to 9 or 8 or 9. It's kind of hard to see on this picture, but there was a pretty violent shaking. They talk about here the population which were affected. For the different levels of shaking. And that's one of the things that shake maps are really important for people that are, when there's a large disaster, they can create these shake maps very quickly and determine how many people they're going to need to be taken care of. You know, there's millions and millions of people. And these can be determined very quickly just by looking at the seismograms. Very important for disaster relief. All right, so there are many reasons why this earthquake was so destructive, but what can this possibly tell us about the next big earthquake? Okay, we've already we've seen the damage from this one, the loss of life, etc. But what can we say about the future? Scientists, unfortunately, cannot yet predict when precisely an earthquake is going to occur, but they can say where an earthquake is most likely to occur. And that's better than nothing. So where do you start? You start by looking at historical earthquakes. So this picture here shows some historical earthquakes that happened in this region. And once again, the Kathmandu earthquake is this rectangle here. The last major earthquake was in 1934, about 80 years before this one, where about the same number of souls perished, 10,000 or so. Very large earthquake, 8.1. and then these are other earthquakes. The ones that are in green are actually ones that were recorded, so ones that we know about for sure. Then there's other ones that happened before seismologists recorded earthquakes, and those are kind of these oval shapes here, in yellow or dim yellow. These are earthquakes that they've gotten from historical records, the written record, and they've actually done some trenching, digging trenches and dating carbon and things like that. And they've got some pretty good handle on some of the dates here. One of the thing about this area that's striking is that these dotted areas are areas where there's no record of an earthquake. They don't know. Obviously, there's movement here. The Himalayas are growing, but they haven't had any earthquakes historically. So these are what we call seismic gaps. Over here, this area is interesting. It's also considered a seismic gap, but they have historical earthquakes here. A gigantic earthquake in 1505, magnitude 8.2, occurred in this area. Let's talk about that one because it's right next to our earthquake here in Kathmandu. So this is something a red flag here for seismologists who are trying to figure out where the next big one is going to occur. Once again, we don't know when, but based on what we see here, whenever you have an earthquake, you're relieving stress in this general area, but you're also changing the stress patterns around you. So This area we know was already must have been under stress. It's historically had earthquakes, and now we've had this large change in stress here. The chances are, indications are, this is where the next big one's going to be, and if it's anything like the one in 1505, it's going to be a really big one. So what are we going to do? The next slide is going to show another pattern that we see here. This is kind of a spatial pattern, but the next one I'm going to show is going to show something pretty interesting as well. Okay, on this picture, I'm going to just try to quickly go through. There's a lot of colors here and things, but I want to show appears to be a pattern here in the earthquake record, the historical record. And this may give you a better time frame for this earthquake. Once again, we never know when earthquakes are going to occur, but this seems to show a possible pattern in these historical earthquakes. All right, so once again, here's our earthquake in 1934 we had here that was east of Nepal, or east of Kathmandu. And we have our earthquake here that occurred of this year. And then we have this large gap area here to the left that I talked about on the previous slide. That was in 1505, that were the last earthquake there. If we go back further in the record, see about 150 years before that, there was a large earthquake, 1344, spatially roughly equivalent to our earthquake of this year. And then if we go another 90 years back, 1255, we have an earthquake here roughly equivalent to the 1934, which occurred 80 years before ours. So we have 90 years between these two, 80 years between these two, so that's kind of a pattern that's repeating. We have 150 years, therefore, between this one and the one in 1505. So one might believe that we have another, you know, the next large earthquake is going to happen here sometime in the next, 150 years or so. When? Who knows? No one has any idea, but the indications are, based on the historical record, that this is where the next one is going to be. And so now is the time to start thinking about what they're going to do in this area. And if it's as big as the one that happened in 1505, it's going to affect Kathmandu as well. So once again, it's not the earthquakes that are killing people, it's the buildings. So well-planned and engineered buildings didn't really collapse or suffer severe damage. But poorly designed buildings were pretty much destroyed. So what I believe, and those who know much more than me, we should really be putting spending efforts in building structures which are more tolerant to earthquake shaking. When possible, even retrofitting those which are still safe to use. We need to take this opportunity to improve Nepal rather than just restore it to where it was. So I know this is a challenge for a developing country like Nepal, but now is really the best time for changes in building practices to take place while the suffering is so fresh in all of our minds. And finally, I want to end on a happier note. I believe that there is in this tragedy opportunity and hope for a better tomorrow for Nepal. We've seen many before and after pictures of buildings in Nepal, but I'd like to end with this picture of a today and tomorrow picture of this little soul who was found after being buried beneath the rubble for about a day. But today, she's fully recovered, and what I believe is the picture of the future of Nepal. So, indeed, there is always hope. Thank you very much, and good night.